Nobody can point the finger at this man and say he does nothing. This man is responsible, in one way or another, for the British Constitution Group, the UK column newspaper, an organisation called Common Purpose Exposed, which is very much Brian's thing. He's become a major speaker and a regular speaker at Ian Crane's Alternative View. And more recently, or at least in the last year, he's held three national Lawful Rebellion conferences calling for, literally, seriously, a lawful rebellion. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Mr. Brian Gerrish.
Yeah, that's good. Okay, well, first of all, thank you, all of you, for coming along to listen to me. I want to thank Malcolm and Inquiring Minds for all their efforts and the Royal Oak for hosting us tonight. But without these venues and the opportunity to speak, we don't get a message across. So thank you all very much for doing that. I'd like to also say thank you to Mike Robinson, who's standing over on my left. Mike gave up a life in the south of France to travel back to UK to work with myself and the team in Plymouth in order to help the paper go and grow and also to fight for his country. And I think that took a lot of courage to give up sunshine in the south of France for Plymouth. But it just shows you that out there amongst us all are some brilliant people and we need to find them. And this is what this evening is about, is can we get a message across? Can we get a feel out for other people in the community who are worried about the state of the nation? Now, there's somebody else in the audience I'd like to thank, who's Robert Francis. And I'm trying to remember how many years ago, but I'd started to discover some strange things going on in the country. I tried desperately to get some people to listen to what I knew without much success. And eventually I passed some paperwork out, and unbeknown to me, that paperwork was given to Robert Francis. And he discussed it with a guy called Harry Beckoff. And then one Friday evening, I think it was, I got a phone call saying, "Are you Brian Gerrish?" And I said, "Yes." And I was invited to go to Marlborough. And I was quite suspicious at that stage because I'd been living an interesting life of threats and intimidation. And I wasn't too sure who the person speaking to me was, but he was very insistent that I should come and meet him and a friend. And when I drove to Marlborough a couple of days later, I met Robert Francis and Harry Beckoff, who I hope some of you have heard speak. And when I sat down with them and revealed what I knew, Harry Beckoff immediately said, "You've got a huge part of the jigsaw." So what I'm going to give you tonight is a little mixture of things that I know and have discovered. I've given talks on individual subjects. I've given talks on common purpose. Tonight, because I'm not quite sure where you all are, presumably some of you have heard some of the other talks that I've given, I'm trying to cover all of the ground and make it sensible for people who are going to see the videos. But I can only be here tonight because of the support that I've been given from people in the audience. Hi, John. So a big thank you from me. In about 3 years, I think it's roughly 3 years, I've now given over 110 talks at various venues. And we're getting responses from people across the world to what we're doing. So we know the message is going out. And what we need now is to find a way that more ordinary people are getting the message out themselves. We need to stop what is happening. And if we don't stop it, not only are we going to have a rotten life, but our children are not going to have any life. And I mean that as I'm saying it. They will not have any life. We've got the youngest member of the audience I've ever had at the back of the room. And I'm very grateful for that. So if it's not about ourselves, it's about our children and our grandchildren. Now, I have a problem because if I dress down, I can't possibly have ever been a naval officer. And if I dress up, then I must be a suit, not to be trusted. So tonight, because Malcolm beefed up the theme that I was in the Navy, and I did serve in the Navy for 21 years, I've gone for the full issue. So I've got a picture of one of my ships that I served in, HMS Sirius. This was back in about 1982-83, but I spent 21 years in the Navy. I left as a Lieutenant Commander. I was not a submariner, but my expertise was chasing, tracking, finding Russian submarines. And this is one of the ships that would have done it in the mid-1980s when we were still in the Cold War period. So a lot of my life was spent around there, working, eating, sleeping. You guys paid for it because I was paid out of taxpayers' money and I had 21 brilliant years. But in the end, I started to see funny things happening. My last job was in command of an offshore protection vessel called HMS Orkney. And we patrolled particularly the North Sea and up the north, off the north coast of Scotland, looking after the fishing fleet, but also enforcing European fisheries policy. And I watched as our fishermen were treated as fifth-class citizens and the European rules were applied in such a way that slowly but surely our fishing fleets were put out of business. And on one dark, stormy night off the Firth of Forth, I stopped a Scottish fishing boat. He had broken the rules because his net mesh was too small. And the instructions that I had from the Ministry of Agriculture and Fisheries and Food was that his net was to be confiscated. And when I explained to the captain of the little fishing boat this was going to happen, he swore at me repeatedly and very strongly. And he said to me that basically I was destroying his livelihood. And what I absolutely hated was I knew that man was correct. And that was one of the triggers that made me decide to leave the Navy, because I knew that even inside the Royal Navy, something nasty was at work. Now, what I'm going to talk about tonight is much broader, but I've given you a bit about me, and I have no regrets. I've been threatened, my family's been threatened. I now regularly mix with other people that are threatened and intimidated by the state. I have people asking if I'm worried that I'm going to be topped, and I say to them, but surely this is Britain and it's a democracy, and they say to me, well, you're into some heavy stuff. I'm not bothered. I am really not bothered, because if I don't fight now, I know that my children have not got a decent life. And this is the message I'm trying to get across to you. We've got to wake up. We've got to wake up very quickly and do some things. But why have we got to wake up? We need an alternative government, because I'm going to try and prove to you tonight that the government we've got is not only rotten and immoral, but it's now starting programs which almost defy belief, because I firmly believe that we are heading towards programs such as eugenics. The selection of individuals. We are starting to see programs come into schools where the government is teaching children that some people are better than others, and if they get a bit too weak or infirm, they're going to be allowed to go. That's what the assisted suicide program is about. And as one of the papers reported a couple of days ago, this is how the Nazi program started. So it's very serious. I sometimes hate talking about the subjects I'm talking about, because I'd much rather make you laugh. I hope I will at some stage. But I have a job to do, and the job's to tell you the truth. You can challenge me. You can run away and hide, but it won't do you any good. What we've got to do is rebel. We've got to stop it happening. So we're going to go down into a hole, and then I'm going to bring you up the other side to say what can be done. I'll come back to these at any time for you, but these are some of the websites that we've got. This is the one for the newspaper, the UK column. Mike has done all the work on these sites. This one is the British Constitution Group, which is saying we need to teach people that not only do we have a constitution, but we need to protect it. How can I prove to you very easily that we've got a constitution? It's simple. All of the Commonwealth countries have got a constitution based on our constitution. That's a simple fact. So we must have a constitution for them to have done that. But Gordon Brown and the Labour Party, and also Mr. Cameron, who's an equal deceiver, are trying to say that we don't have a constitution. So this group, this initiative, which is growing very quickly, is to actually prove to people, not only have we got a constitution, we need to use it. And this is the other part. It's no good being passive. We've got to get out there and do things. And we came up with the concept of lawful rebellion, because that is a lawful statement. If the government isn't doing what it should do, you have the lawful right to rebel. But that doesn't mean violence. It means that you are going to say, no, we're not having what you're offering, and we're going to take power away from you. So those websites will call up at any time you need them. Now, this cartoon I've used a lot, and I haven't got anything better. It works every time. And I can also say that this was provided by another member of the Marlborough community who commissioned it for me. Something's wrong, isn't it? If I say to you as an audience, how many of you think that something is wrong in this country at the moment? Can you put your hands up if you think I'm right? So I can't tell because I can't see the people at the back, but if you're still awake, it's somewhere close to unanimous. Something's very wrong. And if we read the papers and we listen to the news, a lot of it is very easy to pick up. We know we've got politicians who have not only fiddled, have they fiddled or have they stolen money? But at the moment they're being let off. The rules are being changed so that they can carry on doing it. We've got corruption, treason. We've got a perverted sexual education coming. If you want to know what I mean by that, I mean that children are starting to be taught that heterosexuality is not normal. Heterosexuality is not normal. We've got weird quangos appearing who are taking more and more power, but they're not accountable to anybody, but the people in them are paid huge amounts of money. We've got families being broken up. We've got bent, perverted judges. This is a huge problem. And on that subject, I'd like to recommend that you go and look at a website called The Flying Vet, I think that's .com, which is about a gentleman called Maurice Kirk, who until yesterday was incarcerated in Cardiff prison because he knew too much about the fraud and corruption in the police in South Wales. They spent weeks trying to brand him as mentally ill, and eventually he was in court trying to defend himself, with the judge refusing to let him have the papers he needed to conduct his defence. Now, I'm delighted to say that yesterday the jury found him not guilty on both counts. And after the trial, the jury, most of them, went to a pub where they embraced Maurice and his family, and they said that they had never witnessed such a disgrace in a British court before. This is not unusual. And when we know that at the moment we are having our first court case in Britain to do with a robbery, where there is not a jury, we should start to be very concerned.
Could I just add to that, Brian?
You may, Peter, but something I meant to say is I will take questions at the end, because I'm just going to try and move forward through as quickly as possible. Peter, I'll take it since you've started.
I'm friendly with Frank Warren, who yes. acted as a sort of legal assistant to Maurice Kirk.
Yes.
And I've spoken to Frank each day as the case has progressed. About a week ago, they deprived him of his medication.
Correct.
And he's not been allowed his medication for the last week of his trial, which is just unbelievable.
Well, I've heard this before. I have a friend who also spent some time in prison as the result of government corruption, and he was denied heart medication. And I believe that one of the tricks that the prisons use is when you go into prison, the prison budget is responsible for providing the medication. So if they want to save money, the prisoners don't get the medication. You can check that. I'm going to take questions at the end, Margaret, sorry. Okay, now, we are living all of this chaos at the moment. If you listen to what comes up on the news, on the radio or the TV or what's in the paper, it's becoming obvious that the country is starting to break down. Things don't work, people are confused, there's constant change and disruption. Now, what I'm going to do is take you above this cloud to say what is actually going on at the top, because this is not accidental. It isn't that we, the British, even with the influx of new people living in the country, it isn't that as a nation we've suddenly become stupid or incompetent or thick or lacking in common sense. What is actually being done is that we are being subjected to an actual process of breaking down our community and society. The evidence, a lot of it, is in the papers. So basically, we've got this one as an example where David Cameron is busy spouting that he can do things. He is going to look at how many people are coming into the country. If anybody's worried that I'm racist, I go and give the same talks to other groups of people, including Muslim people. And those people themselves recognise that there is a problem to do with how many people are coming into the country at the moment. But this article is saying to David Cameron, David Cameron, you are not in control, Brussels is. And that is absolutely factually correct. And you are simply watching Cameron, as we call him, a cabbage patch doll, being dangled around by other people. David doesn't like me very much, and we have been told by sources reasonably close to David Cameron, I better use the word allegedly, that allegedly when he gets into power, he's going to legislate to stop people like me talking about what I'm talking about. Well done, David. So this is the Mail on Sunday, and this man's got it about right because he's starting to warn people that we're seeing communists come out of the woodwork in the European Union. And this paragraph over here specifically starts talking about communists out of the old Soviet Eastern Bloc countries that are now beginning to appear in the European judicial system. Now, one of the things I'm going to say to you is that when I was a naval officer, because of the work I did, which was partly connected to the nuclear deterrent, I spent a lot of time with access to what is known as intelligence type material. And I was fascinated that when I was at work, I was seeing the Soviet and the communist threats still in place. And then more or less one evening I came home and the BBC said that because the Berlin Wall fell, that was the end of communism. And I was rather puzzled because when I went back to work, the material we were receiving carried on as normal. In fact, we watched as the Soviet Union changed form, but began to restructure so that it was in fact much more efficient, and it replaced old military equipment with new military equipment. None of this was ever reported on the BBC, and I came to the conclusion very early on that I was watching propaganda by the BBC to mislead people. I don't know how many of you would know, but at the moment there are major pacts set up between Germany and Russia to do with the development of military industrial capability. These are things never reported to us, and they need to be. I'm jumping around and I'm doing it deliberately because I want to just try and get you thinking. And many of you have seen this slide before. It always works. This is artwork that popped up in Basingstoke. And the local, well, sorry, that was probably a bit of a pun. But The local children worked it out because they called it the Wicked Willy. Now, if you go round towns and urban areas, you will see very strange artwork appearing. A lot of it can be rusty, jagged metal. You look at it, there's nothing of beauty in it. But what it actually does is starts to play on your mind. If we ask who funded the artwork, nobody wants to tell you. So overall, throughout the country, you look out and you will start to see totem poles, metal trees, jagged pieces of sculpture that have come out of nowhere. Now, I'm going to suggest to you, this is not an accident, somebody's planned this. Now, this is an interesting bit of paper because it tells the story of some people who were refurbishing a house over a number of years. And the weekend before they were due to occupy the house, it was occupied by Romanian squatters. And of course, the mail has blasted this out to us because it wants to do something with your mind. It wants to make you sympathetic for this poor family, and it wants to make you aggressive and angry at the Romanian squatters. But the government provided the means by which the people, the Romanians, came in the first place. So what is happening in the country when we look at the new population is not their fault, because the government opened the doors and invited them in. And I'm a very suspicious man, and when I start to look at what's happening, I get the impression that we are being gently played with to create antagonism between groups. And there's a reason for that. I'll come back to it. Sorry. This one, very clear. We've now got snoopers' armies appearing. So we're living in British society where local authorities are putting snoopers out to see whether we fill our bins correctly, to see how many people are living in the house, to see whether we send our children to the right schools.
Is that
come on at the top there? I'll come on to that, sir. Now, if we say, what sort of society runs a society with snoopers? The one that comes into my mind very easily is East Germany. Because under the Stasi system in East Germany, a terrible regime existed where people were suspicious of members of their own family in case they were paid Stasi snoopers. And we now see exactly the same philosophy being grown in this country, slowly, step at a time. Slowly creeping in, and then it's announced in the paper as if it's factual and you've all approved it. This may be a little bit dark, so I'll read some of it. This is today's newspapers that we've been reading coming up here, but our ASC rescue services are to be sold off to the French. So we are now putting defence of our coastal areas, rescue of our citizens at sea in the hands of a foreign country, France. There's not enough capacity in the military hospitals. Well, this is hardly surprising because in the 1980s, the government shut down all of the military hospitals, so there was no capability. So this is a barefaced lie by both the Labour and Conservative governments. We're talking about a major offensive in Afghanistan. Now, I haven't got time to talk about Afghanistan, but I will tell you that I have no doubt that there is not a proper enemy in Afghanistan. There are people prepared to kill our troops. But if anybody tells me it's to do with Al-Qaeda and international terrorism, I regard it as complete poppycock. It is nonsense. The war has been created, and the war is about protecting poppy production. Isn't it an amazing coincidence that this offensive has been designed to occur just at the time we're heading for an election? Labour's secret plot to engineer a multicultural UK. It is in the papers. If you get today's paper, you can read the stories where the truth is coming out that the Labour Party made a conscious decision it was going to re-engineer a new society. We weren't asked, we weren't consulted, but they had a plan for a new society. Those of you who've heard previous talks by me on the subject of common purpose will have heard me saying that common purpose is all about re-engineering society. But again, they don't want most people to know what's being done. Children to spy on bad neighbours and they'll get cash rewards. What's that doing? Well, it's making people fearful, but it means that you're not even going to trust children. And this is a very, very cynical psychological technique where we're beginning to break up families. Yeah? Absolutely, 1984. But I'm sure the men in the audience will know that now if you are a male and you go somewhere, you take your children to the swimming pool, you cannot take photographs of your own children without fear of being labelled a pervert. So what's been done is trust between people has been turned on its head, almost 180 degrees. The port of Dover is to be sold to the French. Well, that's very nice of Gordon Brown. Isn't that a decision to be made in Parliament? We knew some time ago that armed police, foreign police, French police, were on British soil in the port of Dover. It was never really reported in the press, but this is a very, very dangerous precedent. We have enough problems with our own police at the moment. There are a lot of good ones, and I can see Albert's come in the back door.
Thank you, sir.
But what is happening? Children of five to get school questionnaires. How many of you knew this? Well, I'm surprised. They're going to get questionnaires to fill in, and based on what a five-year-old fills in, the results are going to be scrutinised by social services, who have already said they will intervene if they perceive there's a problem. The same system is being used in the States on older children, 12, 13, 14, and based on their answers, the government can prescribe them with drugs. If the parents complain or fight, the parents are imprisoned. Check it yourself on the internet. This is what is starting to come in to British schools, and I can tell you we were shocked to discover last week that a company called Cunningham's, if I remember that name correctly, has already installed fingerprinting systems in 600 Southwest schools. Now, if you are the person thinking, well, why would they want to do that? They'd never do anything wrong. I'm going to say I'm not so trustworthy, because when I look at the people in control in this country, and it doesn't matter whether you're talking lords or politicians or people in senior civil service positions, we are finding they're less than trustworthy. But we're now fingerprinting children. And bird flu, we've got a massive stockpile of unused vaccines, but we're now pushing for people and children to be vaccinated. If anybody dares raise their hand about the dangers of these vaccines, then they're quickly dismissed as an idiot or a campaigner. But we are seeing things in the papers saying that something is not right. So the evidence is there. What I'm trying to do for you is put it together, that it's not random, it's not chaotic, we're actually being attacked. Come on, machine. Again, the papers are beginning to pick it up. Or is this propaganda designed to wear you down? It's a bit of both. But we're talking about slow death by the state. And I'm sure you can feel this closing in now. You can't drive your car without worrying about a camera. You've got to deal with your rubbish correctly. You can't say the wrong thing. It's closing in all the time. But this is where you've got to read the papers properly, because in the whole paper, here was a tiny paragraph talking about Labour's involvement with the Soviet agent Jack Jones. Now, there was a big article in one paper a few weeks ago pointing out that Jack Jones was intimately connected with the Soviet regime. He was a paid agent and he was a person selecting Labour candidates. The evidence is there when we dig it up. If you say to me, ah, oh, but all the communists went away and disappeared and became nice people, no, they didn't. So something's going on in the background, and if we read the papers properly, we can see it. Now, this is something that's cropped up all over the place. Nasty things with children. And when we started the newspaper, I did not have any idea of what calls we would get and what people would say. They told us fantastic stories about what was happening with children. And when we investigated, we found that they were telling the truth. So here's the papers talking about social service Stasi. I can tell you that social services can turn up on your doorstep and take your children away, and you cannot do anything about it. If you think you would fight or hit them or complain or get a solicitor or get a policeman, I can tell you it will do nothing. Because at the moment, the social services have been given the power of the Stasi, including secret courts. Judges condemn foul play on adoptions. Well, this is pretty ironic because it's the judges who are facilitating the foul play by covering up in court. And this is the dangerous stuff. Here's Rachel. She's not bright enough to have children. Do you know which step that's taken you to? The next step is Rachel's not bright enough to live. Let's get rid of Rachel. Let's get rid of the disabled people. Where was that policy? Germany. Where did the psychology come from? Tavistock Institute, in my view. Social workers ban a young woman from her own wedding. Whether she's bright enough to get married. The state can tell you whether you can fall in love and get married. This is disgusting. This is Britain. And we need to really wake up and understand how close to the knife edge we are. I'm an optimist. I've seen some tremendous things over the last 6 months where people are waking up, but we need to get out and really tell people that they've got to wake up very quickly. Now, this is a story which I hope you'll have a look at in the UK column and on the internet. It's about a young girl, well, she's now a lady, Down syndrome, but for a period of her life, she was raped repeatedly by a paedophile gang, which included judges and sheriffs and social workers and her carers, men and women, and they included their children as well. A crime was definitely committed because the evidence is there, and this lady's brother died under violent circumstances when he discovered what was going on. But to date, the police, Grampian police, have failed to undertake a proper investigation, although the lady has been paid £8,500 criminal injuries damages. Well, how can they pay her damages if there was no crime? Well, of course, there was a crime, but the crime was covered up because the crime involves people at the highest levels of the state. If you go onto the UK column website, you can click on and watch a man called Robert Green giving you the full picture about what happened to this girl and how it was covered up. And if you say to yourself, I can't watch something like that, you need to, because if we don't confront evil, we're not going to sort it out. This was given to me not very long ago. It's basically a piece of text written by a young girl the night before she was taken away by social services. I'm not going into care, I'm not going into care, I'm not going into care. Dear God, please stop those nasty social workers taking me away. And she then wrote out the Lord's Prayer. And the next morning she was taken away with her sister. Now, I'm a relative newcomer to what's going on with our children in this country, but I can tell you I am absolutely horrified at stories from hundreds of mothers and fathers from across the country who tell a template. Their lives were normal, there's some event, and the next minute social services are taking their children away. This letter is from another little girl. Please, please, please help me. I'm still in pain. This girl was taken away from her mother. I can't give you the name of either of them because I can be put in prison, because this comes under child family law. She had a condition called Zollinger's, which is multiple perforations of the gut, like an ulcer. It is intensely painful, so that the pain radiates through your spine. She was only 11, 12 years old, and social services told her she was imagining the pain. So they took her from her mother after making out the mother had mental problems, which she certainly didn't, and that girl has never been reunited with her mother. I sat in court in South Wales and I listened as a judge prevented the mother from having four witnesses who were all counsellors prepared to testify an oath that their counsel had broken the law in kidnapping this young lady. Meanwhile, he allowed the local authority to have two witnesses from social services. I've been there, I've seen it. If we cannot protect our children, we've really nearly lost our country. Hundreds of cases with evidence, with recordings, with transcripts from court, talking about children being deliberately taken from their parents. Well, here he is, I hope. Come on, Tony.
Yes.
You now know, because Claire Short was one lady brave enough to stand up and say this man misled Parliament. And if he misled Parliament to take the country into a war against a terror threat which has been created, isn't he as big a war criminal as Saddam Hussein? But at the moment, nothing's happening to him. Why? Because the same judges that allowed this to happen, the same law lords, are actually protecting these people. I'm going to suggest to you this man is unbelievably dangerous, and the other people he worked with. And if you think I'm soft on the Conservatives, I'm coming to them. Come on, here we are. It's probably going to jump another one. Sorry, come back. Well, here he is. Here's another one of them. The papers are talking about this man lying in producing the case for taking the country to war. But he's not in prison at the moment. We've got people in prison for failing to pay £500 of whatever it is, local tax. But this man's still outside. Why? Because the country is nearly broken down completely. This is what it's really about. Do you know why they only tell you the people who've died in Afghanistan? Because that's the low number. Every time somebody's killed, on average on a battlefield, 5 to 6 people are severely wounded. But they never tell you the casualties of the wounded, because these are the types of people. We are dealing with a government, a parliament of absolute liars. These young men are supposed to be crippled, because that keeps your mind on Afghanistan and not what's actually happening in the country. Well, there he is. I believe we're very close to home for Mr. Cameron. This is a publicity stunt to make Mr. Cameron look like a rough and tough Royal Marine. Have you seen the posters with him looking rugged? Mao Zedong, Lenin. But this man is a puppet. We've described him as a Cabbage Patch doll because he looks like a Cabbage Patch doll. And if you follow his policy, he is following all of the Labour policy. And why? Because the same bodies are advising him, Demos being a key one, the Young Foundation. If you do your research, you will find this man is not forming policy. It's being given to him by the people I am about to expose. World government. David Icke's talking about it. There are other speakers warning that something is being created we haven't given our permission for. And I'm going to link the two because the common purpose is world government. We have documents which will be released onto these video talks where the government at one stage was saying, what's the best route, the United Nations or the Commonwealth? Did you vote for a world government? Did you have a referendum? If you don't know what the Trilateral Commission is, you need to know. But what's happening is we're being formed into three power blocks. And this one is the one that's causing us the problem. Europe, as a power bloc, is to contain Africa and the Soviet Union. That is a fact and it's provable. Well, here they are. Both of them liars. And look at their language. You've shared with me your stories, the stories people have shared with me. A politics of common purpose, our common purpose. This isn't accidental. These people are sharing the same ideological view, the same political agenda. There's something quite creepy about this at the moment. But we're not seeing anything about America. Although in America, the Tea Parties, if you've heard of that, is the American equivalent of Lawful Rebellion. But they started first. Now, this is a nice bunch of men. Do you recognize any? This one is not Obama. This is Hitler. But the point of this is that it only took a handful of people to take control of Germany and form the Nazi Party with all that followed. It wasn't thousands of the people making the decisions at the top. It was a little nasty band. And those people, that mentality has not gone away. Here's Mr. Balls. He's in charge of our children at the moment, families and schools. And he's a member of the Bilderberg Group. Here's a letter where he's admitting it. And the Bilderberg Group was formed shortly after the Second World War. Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands was the first chairman, and he was a Nazi. This organization doesn't keep minutes that it makes available to the public, but every year they're meeting and making decisions which affect this country and the world. And he even told Porky Pies, because he charged his allowances for travelling there to the state, even though the Bilderbergers say all our people attend as private individuals. So somebody's lying. Is this the man you want in charge of your children? Because he is at the moment. So here we've got something interesting. The Communist Manifesto, the abolition of private property. Do you realise that all of the council housing is now being pushed across into the hands of private companies? It's happening in every city across UK, usually with propaganda and lies so that people don't understand what the housing trust is. The abolition of the family, well, that's well underway. That's why social services are stealing children, pitting husband against wife, partners, the sex war. When was there ever a sex war? That's a nice little term to get us uptight. Women, can they stay in love when they earn more than the man? That's the propaganda. That's working on your psyche because they're going to break the families up. The abolition of countries and nationalities. That's happening. The abolition of all religion. Well, some of you may be spiritual, some of you may be religious, but the thing you can see at the moment is an attack. If I was to talk about Jesus Christ, I'm branded now a loony. Those wicked Christians. And what's interesting is if you go and speak to the Muslims know about the spiritual attack on them as well. And that's because the people manipulating the puppet strings are not spiritual in the way we would want to be spiritual. They're quite nasty people. In the Communist International in 1928, there were some very key objectives set to bring about regional union between socialist nations. Do you know that America is being broken up into regions? This country is. It's nearly there. to level the economies of all nations by introducing a single world currency. Well, we formed the euro, and we are now seeing major upheaval in the international money markets, and that is to force the movement towards this world currency. And ultimately, the regions are going to be forced into this new world order, and we're hearing politicians use the phrase. Well, they're not using it for fun. They mean what they say. Here they are. A few. You can go through New Labour and you pick out all the ones that are communists. This man has a communist background. If I had the same communist background, I wouldn't have been allowed in the Navy. But he's now in charge of the armed forces. So how does that work? I think what this man is helping to happen is that our armed forces are being decimated. They want the injuries, they want the deaths. Why? Because while the troops are over there, we've got to have European troops coming in to help us at home. Have you seen the papers talking about merging the British and the French armed forces? Yeah, get our troops out the country, bring in the foreign troops. Classic takeover of a state. These are all communists. He was helped into power specifically by the communists in Scotland. It's obvious when you look at it. Now, here's a nice lady. I've forgotten her name now. Jackie Smith, is that right? We've got a wonderful organisation called Liberty. Have you all heard of Liberty? A lady called Chakrabarti is involved with that. It's cuddly, it's working for our Liberty. No, it's not. If you do your research on Liberty, you will find that Harriet Harman was connected with a thing called the Lolita's Charter, which was about reducing the age of consent and argued that childhood sexual experiences willingly engaged in with an adult result in no identifiable damage. This was as a result of these two paedophile groups. What these people are working towards is that heterosexuality is not normal, but sex with children is normal. And in Germany, there are papers already on the internet, you can go to the TPUC site and look at them, where they are pushing to make paedophilia legal. So we got Mr. Balls, who's associated with an organisation connected with the Nazis, who were pretty keen on eugenics, and we've got other members of the Labour administration, Harriet Harman. Sorry, I think I said Jackie Smith. Apologies to Ms. Smith. Harriet Harman, who is linked to this lot, but the papers never report it. And here's the Tories. Well, if we look at these men, this man was closely connected with the Nazi Party. That's well known. And we look at their policies with the bankers, who are all intimately connected with the Marxist regime. We see a pattern. And this is why this man simply continues the Labour policy, because he's a puppet. He's not a very bright one. Now, this is what interested me as a naval officer, that when I began to research stuff in the public domain, books that ordinary people could get, I started to find material that I understood because I'd seen it in military textbooks. And this was from a book called The European Union Collective by a guy called Christopher Story. It's very detailed analysis of the Soviet period and Germany from the Second World War. And in it was a table similar to this. And when I read it, I thought to myself, this is happening. This is psychological warfare. This is how you take a country apart, not by guns and bullets, but attacking people's minds. So here's the table, and down the side we've got the areas of society. Here's what's going to be done, and this is the result. And this section is entitled Demoralisation, and it's a 20-year plan to demoralise a nation. And then when you've demoralised them, you're going to destabilise it. And when you've destabilised it and there's a crisis, you normalise it. Can anybody tell me what normalisation is? It's easy, you're normal when you're a communist. That's what it means. So family and society, we're going to break it up so that there's no loyalty. We're going to take health and we're going to produce junk food and you will have enfeebled masses. This isn't a game, because I read the same material in military books. They start with guns and bullets and gas, nuclear weapons, and then they talk about psychological warfare. You're living it, I'm living it. This was basically a more detailed plan. This is the one that actually came out of the book. And I'm going to tell you, we are close to this phase at the bottom, where society is now being destabilized. And what they want, above all else, is for us to be fighting, particularly with the Muslims. Because when there's violence on the streets, they can enact the full range of the counter-terrorism legislation. I am probably regarded as a domestic terrorist because I'm criticising the government. How do you get all of this stuff to happen in society? Well, one of the things you've got to do is get control of people inside the public sector. Now, I'm not going to talk about this organisation tonight. That's the website, cpexposed.com. But if you go onto my website, you can read what an organisation called Common Purpose is doing. It's a charity, it's political, and that can't be. And what it is doing is training people to be future leaders. Wherever we find common purpose, we're finding corruption, and now we're starting to find something else. We're starting to find paedophiles. Common Purpose has written me a very unpleasant couple of solicitors' letters recently because they don't like what I say. But 3 years ago, I warned on camera that within Common Purpose there were paedophiles, and now we've been proved correct, because they're coming to the surface. So you can go on this site and check for yourselves. It's a bit dark. The red dots are the Common Purpose cells spread across the country, and they are injecting a political agenda which is not one you voted for. Read it for yourself on the sites and have a look at some of the other films. Am I telling the truth about world government? Well, this is a document straight out of Westminster, and it's the all-party parliamentary group for world governance. That's a real document. So did you vote for that? Is your MP involved with the parliamentary group promoting one world government? Have they told you? Is it in the papers? No. You've had to come to the Royal Oak to find out the truth. It's phenomenal. Now, the good thing is people are beginning to wake up. And the Lawful Rebellion was an idea which really came from a number of people having seen what's happening in America. Large groups of people, hundreds of thousands in some cases in the States, smaller groups in other parts of the states, individual states, individual communities, are now challenging the senators as to what is going on in America. And if you read the paper about two weeks ago, you'll have seen that a senator in New England, I think it was actually lost his seat or her seat to be replaced by one of the Tea Party people. So it is making an impact in America. And this was the idea of a logo which could show that people in this country were doing things, because most people are getting disheartened that they see the chaos but they can't fight it. Now, this is from a map which is on the British Constitution Group website, and each of the blue dots is basically a cell of people that are now saying we've had enough. They contain people from parties. So this isn't about a party, we're not going to become a political party. These are people who are saying we are going to form a group like this one, where we invite people in from all backgrounds and specialisations, but they know that they want to do something to change what's happening. and it's spreading quite quickly. We're also, we've been over in Ireland talking. There's some brilliant people in Dublin and down in Cork, and we know that the same thing is going to happen there very shortly. At the end of this month, we're doing talks in Kirkcaldy, which is Gordon the Brown's back door, and my goodness, they don't like him up there. Glasgow and Aberdeen, and that's where the abuse of Holly Gregg took place. So we are getting out on the road to rebel, but it's done peacefully. This is the British Constitution Group. If you go on that, you can sign up to become a first point of contact. We don't want you to stop doing what you're doing in your group. We are working to network people. If you're in a group, you do what you think. We don't want to know your contacts, but we want to bring people together so that we've got a movement. This is the early Lawful Rebellion site, and what we're saying to people is, look, if you've got a group, you can be interested in global warming, because it's been pretty cold recently. You could be unhappy with the vaccines, because they're dangerous. You carry on what your initiative is, but if you will adopt the Lawful Rebellion logo, other people can see that there's a movement started. And what this government is terrified of, and what Mr. Cameron is terrified of, and Mr. Clegg, is that ordinary people wake up in sufficient numbers to say, no, we're not having it, we're not doing it, we're not paying it. And that's the movement that this signifies. Now, we've had some good responses to this, because people overseas have said to us, brilliant, we can simply take the American flag and have the dove on it. And if anybody's a little bit more advanced and is thinking, well, the dove is a symbol for ISIS and that's all part of the bad guys, we decided we were going to keep it simple. Most people regard the dove, particularly without the twig, as a symbol of peace. So we've done two things. We've reclaimed our national flag. It's not right-wing aggressive racist, it's our national flag and we should be proud of it. But we're also saying that we are a movement to change this country from the way it is at the moment. So this is what Lawful Rebellion is about. We're not advocating the removal of this or the government, because that would be inappropriate. What we're simply saying is, basically, if you voted for this government or you want to vote for David Cameron, well, you go and do it. But as far as we're concerned, David Cameron doesn't own us. And he can go and play with his toys in Parliament, and he can play with the European Union. But the Lisbon Treaty was unlawful and treasonous, so we are going to start to govern ourselves. It's a very powerful message. Numbers. They're frightened of numbers. When we started, we were sporadic groups. We knew the Marlborough group. We didn't have a group in Plymouth. That is now growing. And if you remember all of those blue dots, it's starting to spread across the country very quickly. It's quite exciting, actually. Now, one organisation says that you've got to lead beyond authority and think out of the box. And that's common purpose. Now, they're working for the bad guys, but we can pick up a few things from them. When your local MP says, but you must do this, you say, why? When are you going to get into Parliament and bring to justice the people who've stolen our money? Challenge them. That's what it's about. So this is it. Lawful Rebellion is not an organisation, it's a state of mind. Instead of sitting at home and deciding you can't do anything, start to do something. If your friend is Conservative Party, they're still your friend. But you are going to be saying to them, are you going to do something or not? And we are seeing some fantastic things happen up in the Midlands, where we've got councillors working cross-party. We've got old Labour councillors suddenly starting to talk to the Conservative councillors again, because they realise how serious the situation is. And that's fantastic. So don't judge people by the party, judge them by them as an individual. Lawful rebellion is your statement that enough is enough, and you are now working alongside others. So if you think about it, if you're sending out letters, you're sending out newspapers, or you're doing anything for your group, just put a Lawful Rebellion logo on it and other people can see which side you're on. So that is the four websites that you might like to go to. And this is our current newspaper, and we decided we were going to go for it. So if you read this article, we've based it around a gentleman called Gerard Batten, and the UKIP people in the audience will know that I've been highly critical of the lack of action by the leadership of UKIP. But on the basis of credit where it's due, Gerard Batten has been exposing these communists and Marxists appearing in the European Union. And since we can already identify them in Westminster, we've pushed out this information and we've got a very good response to it. So I've gone very quickly. I'm going to finish there. Anything you want to challenge me on? Do I really mean that this country is being taken over by a Marxist ideology? I do. I can tell you that military people are getting very nervous at the situation. And I can tell you a lot of ex-special forces people are now talking in terms of what is necessary to defend the country. And I wouldn't joke about these things. Do I enjoy doing what I'm doing? I've met some brilliant people. I'd rather be at home reading a book. But I'm here and I do the other talks, and Mike has travelled from France to join the campaign because what's happening is unbelievably serious. We are just on a knife edge at the moment. We can win, but you've got to get off your bottoms and help us to get other people off their bottoms under Lawful Rebellion. Thanks very much. All I wanted to do is just say a few things to sort of try and package bits. I didn't want to talk about common purpose tonight because I've talked about it a lot. But I have to keep coming back to it. You have to understand the common purpose before you can understand how the bits I've talked about are controlled. Right? You think that everything's... Sorry, that's a bit what's... I'm not allowed to say we think. We think that local councils are still controlling everything. They're not. Control has been pushed sort of sideways into a very muddy pond with the quangos, the regional development agencies, the regional assemblies, and hundreds of charities, the third sector. And if you go to the Charities Commission site, you can start to see them, and I've quoted this before, you're talking about 177,000 of them, and our life is not getting better, it's getting worse. So they're not very charitable, and they've got a budget of 44 billion. So organisations that call themselves charities are not doing nice things. They're being used as a political agenda. We know where this comes from because a guy called Jeff Mulgan wrote a book on it, and he's closely connected with Julia Middleton from Common Purpose, and another new think tank called the Young Foundation, which amongst other things is advising the Tory party. And both those two are linked to Demos, and Demos's background is Marxist. So once you dig into it, you start to see this network. And you have to see the network before you understand how the control works. Now, about a year ago, we were pushing a big stone, and it was pretty depressing sometimes. But about 6 months ago, something started to happen. And I can tell you that in a number of cities, particularly cities up north, local councillors, cross-party, have woken up and they're asking what Common Purpose is doing in their city. And some of them have used some pretty ripe language to say, we want this organisation out of our city. Because they realise that it's being used to control people in the public sector, in finances, in policy, so that they control the agenda in the city and not the elected councillors. I have one Labour councillor in a particular city who, having made a complaint about Common Purpose, was then warned off by his local Labour Party. Keep your mouth shut, don't ask questions. Now that was brilliant because that made him pretty annoyed, and he's now talking to other councillors to say, what is this? Old Labour people are our friends. I mean, we agree with some of their policies, a lot of their policies, and I'm not a Conservative. But what I mean is that we have been driven into this hole of looking at other people by their labels. And I can tell you that old Labour people are looking at new Labour very, very carefully because they realise that they've been conned. And I think the same thing is going on in the Conservative Party. And I had an email, lost track of my days, yesterday, Monday, I had an email from a group up in London who've asked me if I'll go and speak to them. And their objective is to regain old Conservative values. So we are really starting to see some interesting things happen. I'm asked, do I talk to the BNP? And I say, yes, of course, because every time I can get into a BNP audience, I can point out this business that if we end up with violence in this country, we lose. And I can also say in about the, probably six BNP audiences that I've talked to, I have learnt as well, because the majority of the people I've met, the overwhelming majority, were just like you, just like you. But they have got to the point where they cannot stand what is happening, and they've chosen the BNP as a route for doing things. I go and talk to Muslim people. We've now got Sikhs coming to see us and asking whether we'll do talks. So we will talk to any group. I don't want to talk to David Cameron because I don't trust him, and I wouldn't talk to Gordon Brown or Tony Blair. But any reasonable people I will talk to. And this is what we've got to get through, is the labels, because the labels are cultural Marxism, and that controls the way you think. So we've got to get back to looking at somebody. Are they a decent, moral person? A lot of people are frightened about being listened to. And last year or the year before, in Devon and Cornwall police area, they had intercepted 53,000 telephone calls and emails. I hope many of those were mine. We shouldn't be frightened of talking, all right? The way the systems work, automatic voice recognition, it can tell me, it can tell you by your voice, and they will pick up on keywords. And the machines start running, and they can monitor millions of calls per hour. But once you've monitored millions of calls per hour and you're left with hundreds of thousands of selected calls, they've got to go through a screening process. And the screening process is done by people. Okay? And the people are ordinary people. They're youngsters, 25, 26 years old, who believe they've got a very important job in GCHQ or MI5, and they're saving the country. But of course, what they're also doing by listening to our conversations is learning that what's happening in the country isn't quite as straightforward as it should be. And one of the golden rules of dictatorships is that when they finally establish themselves, they murder and dispose of all the people who know too much. So when we are having telephone calls, we regularly speak to the operators the other end, suggesting they need to wake up because they're going to be dispatched. Yeah? So it's not a question of talking less. We want more people to talk more, a lot more. Because if we end up with our million people sending out 100 emails and telephone calls per day, the people listening in have got a big problem. And if you want to get rid of the surveillance state, you swamp it. You don't hide, you swamp it. That is a simple fact and tactic, okay? So don't be frightened. Talk to people, tell them what you're doing, what you want to do. But the only thing I would suggest is you don't necessarily need to say when you're going to do something or how you're going to do it. So you might be very happy to discuss a whole lot of things, but no, I'm not going to tell them I'm going to do that Tuesday next week. I'll do that when I meet face to face. The groups that are set up across the country, we don't want to know who your contacts are. All right? I operate with a whole load of groups. I don't ask them who their contacts are. I don't want to know. I don't need to know. But you need one person to be talking with other people, okay? But imagine it as a resistance movement with little cells. Nobody's in overall control of the cells. The cells know cells close to them, but they don't necessarily know who's running the one down the road in Bristol. Keep it loose. Don't try and control people. Be nice to people. Who joins the network and stays? The person that you know as a person. So if they say they can't do anything next week because their mum-in-law's very ill, you need to be phoning them at some stage asking how the mum-in-law is, because that is how you build trust with people. So it's all to do with cells, and it's all to do with just keeping your business to yourself. If somebody comes along and asks too many questions, they may be inquisitive, they may be a good person, but just be a bit discerning. But don't get in the mentality that you can't talk to other people because they may be on the other side. All that does is draws you into a sort of goldfish bowl, all right? So the Marxist ideology captures our mind, labels people, turns people against each other, makes friction, angst, fear. So we've got to turn it back the other way. We've got to treat people as human beings. Common purpose people and many other people in the public sector have received training involving neuro-linguistic programming. I am not saying that everybody who is a neuro-linguistic programmer is a bad person, but think of it like a hypnotist. You can use hypnosis to stop smoking or maybe cure a fear, or the hypnotist can say, well, good morning, Mrs. X, Mr. X, please take your clothes off. NLP in the wrong hands is unbelievably dangerous because you are directly playing around with people's minds. And this is why we are now seeing a large number of people, and particularly young people, starting to do weird things, self-harm, and commit suicide. And one of the areas we're very interested in is South Wales, where they're now up to 29 suicides. And I can tell you that some extraordinary things are being discovered there, such as connections between the suicides and fraud and corruption and paedophilia involving the local police force. And the chief constable has recently resigned, a lady called Barbara Wilding. She happens to be a member of the Royal Institute of International Affairs, if that means anything to you. And she's been closely involved with the local mental health partnership. Now, of course, I would not suggest that she's done anything wrong, merely that we are beginning to start to look at the strange things happening. But if you want to get into the next stage of understanding why you're seeing weird things, why does a policeman say, I can't possibly get on a bike for a photo shoot, which appeared in the papers? Why did a policeman stop a man who was blowing his nose while parked at red lights? He did it because in his mind he believed it was the right thing to do. And the reason he believed it was the right thing to do is because he's been trained to think that way using neuro-linguistics, which is subliminal messaging. Can I prove it? Yes, because I've shown documents in all of the talks on common purpose where I have shown and named trainers for the police using neuro-linguistics. They are now starting to use it in schools, normally under the title of creative visualization. Anybody who allows themselves to be hypnotized or undergo neuro-linguistics runs the risk of an adverse mental effect. A low proportion, 1 or 2, 3%, but if we are now starting to use NLP on hundreds of thousands of young people, you can expect to see the suicide rate increase, which is what you're seeing. I can't tell you any more about this tonight. You've got to dig it out for yourself. But we are seeing people act abnormally because they're being put through courses. David Cameron, since we're on his doorstep, was quoted in the press as saying that he believed that the Tory party needed to take on board psychometric testing. And the reason he's interested in psychometric testing is he can then screen out the people he needs to join the political ideology. If you think I'm joking, I'm not. I'm absolutely not. The people they're looking for are people who are narcissistic. And they particularly want people who have narcissistic personalities to the extent it is a disorder, NPD. And this is why when you start to look at senior politicians, you look at Mandelson, Miliband, Blair, Brown, Cameron, Osborne, to name a few, they appear to be the same type of people. They're very pleased and proud with themselves to the extent they can't even seem to understand why we're upset about expenses. They don't understand how we feel because they're not actually in their right frame of mind. Now, this stuff is real and it's out there on a huge scale, and they're pumping it through the system by networking. Go on the internet, put in neuro-linguistic programming, NLP, and you will come up with hundreds of consultancies, many of whom are working directly for the government. Okay? So I don't want to scare you, because your mind runs riot with this stuff, and it's the invasion of the body snatchers. But there are a lot of people out there who are no longer thinking in a normal, rational way. Okay? They are victims. So we don't need to be nasty to them. We need to understand they're there and it needs to be exposed, and we're going to work on this. Now, the other thing is, and somebody's already asked me this evening, what about the military? Everywhere we look, the situation's confused at the moment. There's massive corruption in the police, but there's a lot of good policemen and a lot of them are beginning to ask the right questions. Same with the NHS, the same with social services. So we're not saying that this Marxist ideology has turned everybody, but it's doing damage, and we've got to get at the good people. The military, it's also complex. I have absolutely no doubt that we have senior officers in all three services who are total and utter traitors, and we are going to work to expose the worst of them, because they are working for the government's political program. They are not interested in the defense of this country. I can tell you that a lot of ex-special forces people are at the point where they believe appropriate action should be taken, whatever that means. And I can tell you that more and more of the military are realizing that Afghanistan is deliberately being used to kill and maim British troops, so that the army is so weakened we have to call on a joint program with the Europeans. If we allow any of the European armies in this country, we have lost. That is an absolute military fact. And Albert, who I think is still here, is deeply concerned because we're now discovering that people who are not even British are being brought in to be police. And I suggest that when we are faced on the street with two Lithuanian-based officers, their values are not necessarily going to be the same as your local friendly Bobby. So all these factors are there. The good news. In the last few months, we have seen an unbelievable change in people. So the activist groups are forgetting the petty squabbles. We still have a few punch-ups. But if we talk to John Harris, or we talk to what Albert's doing, or we talk what the British Constitution Group's doing, or you listen to what the main major speakers, Ian Crane is another one, they've all got a big chunk of the truth. We may not have it exactly right, but we're now seeing people join together. They have worked to isolate everybody, to make you fearful, confused, mistrustful, antagonistic, and we've got to bring people back together. If you're religious, the churches are shot, absolutely shot. And when I gave a talk in Dublin, somebody asked me very early on, are you a Protestant? And I said, yes, I suppose I am, but I'll qualify it. I've come to the conclusion that the head of the Church of England is a Satanist. And there was a gasp from the audience, and I said, so that entitles me to say I'm highly suspicious of the Vatican. There are ways of dealing with people. And what we are seeing is if you get back to treating people as good, honest individuals until they prove otherwise, you can work with them. So we are seeing this network grow. We know that the cabinet is very frightened at the moment. That's why Blair's paying £600,000 to be protected 24 hours a day. Cameron is so worried about what's happening, and he doesn't like being called a Cabbage Patch doll, but he does look like one. He's so worried, he's telling his team apparently that they're going to legislate against us. And all we've done is got out there and told the truth. So if we can get our million people in the next few months, we're not going to march on Parliament, don't need to. We are simply, in our own ways, going to refuse to cooperate. And I think we're going to see some amazing things happen this year. Amazing. My prediction is, and you can quote me on this, this year is the tipping point. Okay? It's not next year, it's this year. We either get this thing going this year and life gets better, or our children are going to regret it. And I haven't come all this way for my children to regret it. Okay? So you guys are the important people, not me. But you've got to get out there, talk to your friends, talk about what you've heard, what you know, what you believe, and it will happen. Okay? Do a bit of praying as well, because that's important. Okay, thanks. Now, questions, will we just...
Remember the basic rules. You're free to just sit or stand where you are and ask the question, but more than likely, it will be muffled and it will have to be edited.
Come on, be brave and come up to the front.
Brave and come and stand here, be on camera, be on the microphone and have your say.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
I've come here this evening just to listen to you. I've been on the website and you've got to tell me in various papers and so on. I'm quite concerned because I, like you, don't agree that things are going well for many of this country. But unlike you, and I've listened to all the different things that you've taken sections on. In particular, I took great offence to your comments about social services.
Right.
Having worked in both these organisations and had training in NLP to work with people who are mentally ill, but not in the way you've described.
Absolutely.
The statements about social workers taking people out without any backup is absolutely unacceptable. And all it does is actually feeds into, if you listen, read all these things, I'm saddened because there's a feeling of paranoia that comes in there, not from me, but from what the things that are listed there. I'm surprised anybody feels positive about anything when they see those statements. I'm not happy with what's happening in the government. I totally agree with you. I think we need to change things. But sadly, the sort of Daily Mail, I couldn't see because of context, and of where you've got those articles, the things about the schools and bringing paedophiles in, I'm sorry, I can't buy that. There are paedophiles everywhere. Appalling though it is, they are everywhere.
Everywhere.
Life, and they have been there.
Sorry, they're everywhere.
They're everywhere because they are.
So,
they are there, they're not acceptable.
Okay.
I don't like them.
So does... If they're everywhere, does that include social services?
Yes, of course.
Thank you.
The health service, they'll be in every
thank you.
Because human nature, sadly, has people who are like that.
Right, and you believe that's acceptable?
Of course I don't.
Okay, so what are we going to do about it?
Well, we're trying through various laws to deal with people.
Well, we're not.
But, I mean, that's a huge debate, which I can't get into this because I'm not trying
right.
to be working with them or...
You are involved with social services.
Now I'm
okay, you were. Yes. And I said very clearly just now that we're not saying that everybody who's a police officer or everybody in the public sector or everybody in social services is bad. I didn't...
You've added that in the after of it.
No, it's on record because I deliberately said it because it's a very important thing. When you have had a stream of mothers coming to you with their story of how their children were taken away. And initially you're very suspicious because some of them are deeply traumatized. And then mothers come to you and they come with ring files of documents. And what those documents show is false reports, perjury in court, manipulation of the court transcripts, deliberate lies by the police. When you see the documentation, you suddenly start to realize that something very sinister is going on. Now, 2 weeks ago in London, we had a lady join us who suffered unbelievable things. Basically, she was drugged, tied down, and repeatedly raped over a number of years in a children's home called Kendall House. When she left as an adult, she spent time finding other girls who'd been similarly treated. She compiled the documentary evidence in great detail, including the massive amounts of drugs they were subjected to. She took that evidence to the police, she took it to counsellors, she took it to social services, and they did not want to know. This is exactly the same pattern with Holly Gregg in Aberdeen. It's the same pattern with the lady in South Wales whose daughter has still not been returned to her. If you said to me, Brian, you were a naval officer, every naval officer was an upstanding, honest person, I would laugh. I would absolutely laugh. But the evidence, if you had come to Bristol about a month ago, I did a talk about child snatching by the state.
But Brian, with all due respect, you're picking out cases. I can't argue because these are complicated scenarios.
They're not complicated at all. No, but
we know that the cases of taking right. children away, there are children who are not
yes.
removed to die.
Yes.
Who are born in conditions.
Yes.
And once again,
yep.
everybody condemns the system because yep. they die.
Yes.
And when they're taken away, there are occasions when one could question whether.
Not occasions. We're seeing large. No, we're not talking isolated. We are absolutely not talking isolated cases. On what is your evidence? I'm going to stick with this. No, I haven't got a view. I am presenting evidence. Just a moment, if I may. I am not presenting a view. I am not so foolish that I stand up on stage and am recorded saying the things I say without knowing that everything I'm talking about I can prove. And something that has been absolutely shocking to understand from the fact that the government introduced a regime of secret courts in which perjury is committed, paedophile judges are sitting, documentation is interfered with, court transcripts are rewritten, and it is happening on a phenomenal scale. It is not an accident that the government introduced a system of targets for adoption, and based on the number of children that were taken for adoption, city authorities and local councils have raked in millions of pounds in some cases. This is not an accident. This is a deliberate program. I do not have a view. I deal in evidence. And if you would like to come and sit with me in Plymouth, because I cannot travel all around the country to sit with each individual, if you like to come with me in Plymouth, I will show you the first case that opened my eyes. And when you see the documentation and you put the case together, you will see that a doctor worked in conjunction with social services to take a sick girl away from the mother by trying to brand the mother as ill with Munchausen by proxy. And if you think, Well, if you want to, if you, no, there isn't. It's been discredited. If you want to live in the bubble you're in, which is that we live in a normal society, please continue to live in it. Okay. But what I say to you is, I deal in evidence, and that is why at the moment I have stood up and taken common purpose apart, including warning of the paedophile penetration in that organisation, because we have the evidence. And when we follow the trail through, time and time again, no MP will take action. None of them. None of them. When you sit in a court and see a mother denied four local councillors as her witnesses to say under oath that their council broke the law in that there was no documentation in place to justify taking a girl from her mother, not in this country, in America. And when you read one of the transcripts where the judge actually says in the transcript that when the girl was taken, as far as he could see, the mother had not broken the law. This is evidence. And when you talk to the mothers and fathers, because this is across both sexes, they will tell you stories where there's a template, how social services lied. I was talking a few nights ago to a gentleman who's in Ireland. Why is he in Ireland? Because he ran away to try and protect his two sons. Why was he trying to protect his sons? Because his wife went into hospital. And when she was in hospital, the treatment was so appalling they nearly killed her. And in fact, they made her blind. So he started a series, quite rightly, of complaints against the local health authority. What happened? Social services turned up on his doorstep. And over a period of months, stretching into years, a case was engineered that his children should be taken away from him. He eventually ran away with his wife to Ireland, and those children have been taken away from him. I get a call from a lady near Cork. So she's Irish. And she tells a similar story of children being taken away. And she said, Brian, I'm there and I'm with the social services people and they're just lying. Ladies in Cornwall, ladies in Glasgow, ladies in Newcastle. And there is a pattern. And the pattern is that children are being deliberately taken away from their families. Now, one of the things that I learnt in the Navy, something I've never forgotten, is a little film watching a goat die from nerve agent. That's a fun occupation for a morning. And what it taught me is there are people out there who are unbelievably evil. They are so evil that you and I can't comprehend because we can't even think like it. But because we can't think like it doesn't mean these people don't exist. After one of the talks, two policemen came up to me. This was in Heathrow. Sorry, one policeman and his colleague who was not a policeman. And he said, Brian, I want to tell you something. He said, you mentioned children. He said, a few months ago, I spent several months with a group of colleagues investigating child trafficking, child prostitution, paedophilia in London. It was obvious to us that there were a number of very high-level gangs. We finished the investigation, we produced a brilliant report, we put the mechanism by which this lot could be dismantled. It was given to our superior officer. 3 weeks later, we were told to drop the case. Are you familiar with Operation Orr? Operation Orr was a big paedophile investigation following the release of about 4,500 names by the American police of paedophiles operating in this country. An investigation started. it began to identify people up the social ladder. A few of the little minions went to court. It began to look at people who were MPs, editors of major newspapers, lords, judges, and then all of a sudden, Mr. Blair shut the whole inquiry down. That's fact. Why would he do that? Why would he do that? Well, I know why he did it. Because he's got something to hide for himself or his colleagues. I could give you, and in fact, on the end of March at AV4, I am going to be talking about confronting evil, which is what we are talking about, and it's very difficult because you don't want to hear some of the subjects that I get told and have to talk about. Do you remember Jersey? And they said, oh, well, there's no problem because we've only found a few milk teeth. Do you remember that?
Yes, sir.
What they didn't tell you is that they enjoy knocking the children's teeth out so they don't hurt the men when they're sucking them.
Oh.
I wish that I didn't have to deal with the things that I've learnt over the last 4 months, 4 years, but the thing that motivated me is that I realised this society was not protecting our children. And we have a massive problem. I know that many police are deeply, deeply frustrated that they can't unleash their full talents to get these people out of our society. So when, as I've shown you on a view graph, I have politicians in power who've been campaigning for pro-paedophilia type actions, we need to start worrying. And when documentation is being produced in the European Union, in Germany, saying that paedophilia should be made legal, and we are linking to Germany, we should be worried. Tonight, and somebody perhaps may own up, I was given a press cutting about a party that was set up in Holland specifically for paedophiles, and they also believe that bestiality should be included in the permitted sexual activities. Albert said at a talk recently that when the law becomes this perverted, you are dealing with satanic law. Now, I don't want to go that far in this talk. I'm giving you that as a throwaway comment. You may think I'm being very hard on you, but what is happening, and we can prove it with documentary evidence and tape recordings and the testimonial of many, many people, is something very, very nasty. If you listen to the other speakers warning about what's in the vaccines that are being pumped into people. The cervical vaccine, within a few weeks, we had one girl paralyzed and a total of 1,200 other young girls suffering severe effects. Never reported, never challenged by MPs. So something is very serious at work. If you think that evil people have disappeared from the world, oh, they haven't. And our problem is that we have led, I'm guilty as well, fat, warm, well-protected, comfortable lives. And we think that the people that are of the ilk who created the Soviet regime or the Stasi regime or the Nazi regime, we think they don't exist. Well, they do. That's why I joined the Navy in the first place, actually. I'm sorry to be so tough, but I haven't come all this way for you to say to me that because you've got friends or you've worked in social services, what I am saying is not true. Come to me, come down and see me, and I will spend a day with you, and in fact, I'll get a couple of the women to come as well. And you can hear yourself what they have to say, and you can look at the documentation. That's my challenge.
If all these cases are true, I'm not saying they are. I just think the general tone is one that is extremely depressing.
It is depressing, you're absolutely right.
Borders on, there are levels of paranoia, which I don't share.
So you're attacking my mental...
I'm saying general, some of the scenarios, I think...
Do you believe that everybody that uses NLP is honest in what they're doing?
No, I don't believe that.
Right. Do you know that courses are being run where the people going into the courses or the children are not even told they're being subjected to NLP?
I mean, you could be right. I am right.
Yeah,
okay,
it's not
right.
Could be. So we have young children, a few years old, in schools being subjected to NLP. Their parents don't even know. I have a report written by a teacher in Leeds. I verified it. I know the course took place. I have a copy of the contract where teachers were being taught creative visualization, which is a form of NLP. The teacher said in her report that after the training, one of her colleagues suffered from very dark, depressing images in her mind, which she couldn't shift. And it was beginning to make her very frightened and uncomfortable. The teacher also said she was very uncomfortable with the fact that they were told when they give the children the creative visualization training, they had to count down from 5 to 1 to bring the children back into reality. Now, when I spoke to Education Leeds, and I have the documentation, and I found out who had given the course, I discovered it was a gentleman who had the extraordinary qualifications of a combined degree in geology and psychology. I discovered that when he gave the training to the teachers, he had friends of his from Switzerland in the classroom. Who were they? And the best bit of all is the contract I got was not signed. So at the time he gave the teachers the training and he's given children training, there was no insurance in place. When you look at South Wales, and 29 people have died through suicide in a very small geographic area, there is a reason for it. And when you get into the suicides, I'm sorry to go down this very dark hole, when you get into the suicides, you find something odd is going on, because there is a recognised preference of suicide. Girls like to take pills and slit their wrists. Men and young men quite often prefer to hang themselves. But in South Wales, something extraordinary has been happening because all this is reversed. Now, aside from South Wales police failing to investigate the suicides effectively, another authority started to investigate. And this is when some rather nasty things under the surface started to materialise. I am not the only person bringing this message. It is very serious, and if you go away from here, you are probably going to say, he can't be right. And I'm going to say to you, I am right. And we have very little time to stop a very, very nasty regime installing itself.
Can I just ask you, though, Cathy, please, can I just intervene?
You can come straight in after me. Can I just broaden this out a little bit for everyone's benefit and point out the fact that I've got a wad of postcards here, which on one side says, hope, don't drop it. Because on the other side, it says, psychopaths rule our world. Now, I'm not sure how many people are aware of this, but there is a considered opinion that there is an element within human beings, which is a sort of subgroup, who are genetically, that means they're born that way, psychopathic.
Or sociopathic.
That may possibly be misconstrued. But the fact of the matter is that there are people who don't feel guilt. They don't feel empathy. And they couldn't give a monkey's what they do to other human beings. And Graham has very kindly come up from Bath today with a range of books, Red Pill Press, the backbone of which is Laura Magdalena.
Yeah,
it's Polish. and she's married to a book called Political Ponerology. I've mentioned this to dozens of people over the past 4 years, and the usual response is, political what? Well, it's ponerology. Now, ponerology is the study of evil. It's a branch of theology that deals with evil. And political ponerology describes how, let's say for argument's sake, for the sake of a better word perhaps, people with a psychopathic disposition work their way into society, and in actual fact, as far as I'm concerned, they have created corporations in their own image, and they are taking over humanity. The subgroup of humanity are taking over. They're well underway on their program. Kathy?
I didn't know it at the time, but I was actually working for a paedophile. He was a very, very well-known, extremely famous politician, and his best friends were a very famous artist and also a high court judge, and they all went to the same school, and these men were in their 80s. When this old man died, his last words to his wife was, "I've been a bastard." And I found videos afterwards of what he'd been doing, and it was mostly boys, and they started at maybe 2 years old. There was a lot of, not masochistic,
sadistic.
And these boys went up to about 14, 15. Anyway, my question is, when you're dealing with these such powerful people, how do you do anything?
Because they're terrified. They are absolutely terrified of exposure. And what I am doing, and you may think I'm getting emotive, and I am, because this is to do with children. But when you actually stand up and use the words with people and tell them the truth, and that involves using some unpleasant words, you see, it's almost like they snap awake and then they pay attention to you. But I did a talk in South Wales on one case for that mother. There were 72 people in the room, and it was unbelievable, the tension in the room. And before the end of the meeting, there were people saying, "We've got to do something about this." And I hadn't finished, and they were swapping numbers and saying, "Where do you live? You're close to me. We need to go and see the counsellor." And it was phenomenal, because what was happening was those people were starting to get motivated. So I have gone into one specific very dark area, but if you want to know how bad the people are we have in power, we're not dealing with people corrupted by power, wealth, homosexual or lesbian, whatever they want to be, fine. We're not just at that level, we're dealing with people who like abusing children. And I will say, not what I can prove at the moment, but what I believe. I believe that these people have formed groups that are so powerful, they are using our public system to feed their habit. And I've got police officers who communicate with me who also believe that. And I can tell you that some of the other people motivated in this subject are retired police officers and some special forces people who operate groups digging information. The corruption in Westminster is virtually absolute, and the few good people have not got the guts to stand up. Why has it happened? Because if you discredit our parliament with these horrible things, people turn against it. And then you say quite calmly, "Well, we don't really need Westminster because we got Brussels." Well, thank you. Yeah? So these are very dark, heavy subjects. And on one hand, I apologise for giving them to you. But we are adults. And there are no wars without people getting blown up and killed, or children or innocent people getting hurt. Mr. Blair thinks there is, but there's no such thing. And we have got to get to grips with things. I've given some talks in churches, and that's extraordinary, because a lot of churchy type people, they don't want to know anything about love and light. They don't want to hear about the wicked stuff. And that is why the churches are crumbling, because they have also been subverted. Most of the people, coming on to a lighter subject, who are spiritually aware, operate from home in small groups. They will not go near the established churches. Yeah?
Brian, when you said that the whole of Westminster is corrupt, etc., you were saying that in the context of observations about paedophilia. So were you actually saying that you suspect that paedophilia is rampant in the power?
I think it is.
Or just that it's corrupt?
I think that there is sufficient paedophilia in Westminster to form a core of major corruption, because that is the ultimate hold you have over somebody. You can be homosexual these days, nobody's bothered. Perhaps that's quite right. But you cannot be an abuser of children. It is not acceptable. So as you see the tone of morality drop, so you have to use something worse and worse in order to control and infect people. Now, a police officer said to me, and this is the interesting thing, I don't go finding these people, they come to me with information. His words were, Brian, if you want to find the paedophiles in Westminster, you should start by looking at the Tory party. Now, maybe that policeman was completely off his rocker. Maybe he was having a joke. But I'm going to say, I don't think so. And if anybody's aware of a magazine called Scallywag that was printed in the early 90s, they will find some very detailed analysis of very unpleasant things going on amongst people in the political realms. Now, if I may, I'm going to stop talking on that subject, because that is the worst scenario. The rampant use of NLP without people's permission with a political agenda is very dangerous, but the fact that we are not recognising what's being done to us is the most dangerous. So all we need to do is say we are seeing it, and then we can do something about it.
Could I just say, I wonder whether, if it is as widespread as you projected, and certainly there's vast amounts of evidence, I wonder if there's not some force or phenomenon who making it their job to introduce paedophilia into influential circles with a view to compromising people who might be useful to their cause later on.
Well, if I go back to the Soviet doctrine, and the reason that when I joined the Navy and when other people joined the military, depending on what classification of material you were going to have access to, you had a total background check, your family were checked, your drinking habits, had you been unfaithful to your wife, were you a closet homosexual, all of these things were checked. And the reason why was because you could be blackmailed. Now, if you talk about putting people under pressure now, how do you do it? So somebody's, well, let me think of a member of parliament who's used Brent Boys.
Oh, just up there.
Well, whoever it is, I'm not going to say on camera, but we know we have MPs who are now at the stage of using Brent Boys or advertising for partners in their underwear on websites. That is the level at which our parliament has got to. Now, if that is the base level, and you are a particularly evil person, how do you put pressure on them? Let's drag them down a bit deeper. Let's go for 14-year-old girls. Well, I'm not interested in those, they say, so then you offer them the other side.
Do you know if the book, The Gulag of the Family Courts, is still available?
Yes, it is.
That lady might find it very interesting trying to get hold of a copy of that book. Because if you want detailed analysis, factual backup, that book is unbeatable.
Thank you. You might also look at a gentleman called Ian Joseph, I can't remember the address for his website. He's in Monaco, and he is a very generous, quite wealthy man, and he helps all sorts of mums and people with problems over their children. And in his book, one of the key bits of advice that he gives is don't go near social services. Now, he may be wrong, but I'm just quoting the advice.
Right, Brian, now yes. can you refresh my memory? You probably know this off the top of your head. There's a very good documentary which was made by Yorkshire Television, which goes into British and US paedophilia on a massive level, which goes right up to politicians and people, you know, in high positions of power, who had, you know, literally they could pick up the phone and they could have 40 or 50 boys on an aircraft going to Las Vegas to be buggered. And this was regular business. And Yorkshire Television were putting this out, and they got bought out by the paedophiles, and they were saying that the children in this documentary were saying that they had been threatened and basically went underground, and some of them even disappeared after the documentary had been made.
Yeah.
And can you remember what it's called? Because
I'm afraid I can't. And just if I may, because yeah. I can't, I have heard what you're talking about, but I can't substantiate that. That
right.
Part of it.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's available on YouTube because it got leaked.
Okay.
They thought it was destroyed, but somebody in Yorkshire Television pulled a copy out before they destroyed it.
Right.
And it's there, and it's full Yorkshire Television. And Yorkshire Television
right.
said, yes, we did make this, but we did stop.
Right. What I can tell you is that in this case, the Holly Gregg case, that the BBC was going to do a documentary to expose what happened to this girl. And the team who were going to make the documentary were warned off by senior people in the BBC. Not only that they would not go near that case, but they would not be reporting on any other paedophile cases in Scotland. And that's a fact, and we hold the information on it.
Sir? Are you saying that this paedophilia problem is fundamental to what's wrong with the country?
Or it's symptom.
Just one small aspect of our.
Well, safety of our children, I would suggest, is a very, very important issue. But it's a facet, which is prevalent enough that we need to really pay attention to what's going on.
So yeah. What sort of scale are you trying to say it's at? I mean, are you saying that 20% of MPs are?
I can't possibly say, but I can say to you with certainty that one of the things the police want to do at the moment is actually have a centralised unit to tackle paedophilia, because they're finding that their actions within a police area are not able to keep up with the UK-wide gangs. So the police at the moment, and if you've got police friends, you can go and check it out, are actually really trying to ramp up their ability to deal with these gangs. And of course, one of the things that's causing problems is we now have so many people coming into the country who are unidentified that they can disappear very easily, and particularly young people.
Brian,
yeah.
Did you want to change subject?
Yes, please.
Has anyone got a question? On a different subject.
Can I just endorse what you've been saying?
Wait.
Come back. Finish with Sheila Phillips, but it's done good. We'll get back to it after midnight. Your question, please.
You were talking earlier about the regionalisation and the split on the
Yes.
I'm just interested to know about in Northern Ireland at the moment, there's like devolution of Parliament. Is that a good thing?
I personally don't believe it is, but I think Mike perhaps might like to comment since he's from... You don't? Okay. The devolution, everywhere we see devolution, it's advertised as giving power down to the local community level. If you actually look at the mechanisms by which that devolved power works, it deals in terms of what are called stakeholder groups. And if you look at a stakeholder group, it consists of a group of people who have been appointed as representatives of varying organisations. So a stakeholder group might have a member from the local primary healthcare trust, somebody from the local police, somebody from the local university, a charity, very often Common Purpose is used for that. And so you'll have a cluster of people and they will make the decisions. And when you see the reports and the minutes written up afterwards, they claim their democracy from the fact that they were representative of the community. But they are stakeholders, they are not elected, you can't remove them, you can't track what they're doing. So what I see, and this is actually one of the things short of the fishing industry that I began to get interested in, is that you see the government talking about getting power down to the communities, but when you see the form that power is implemented in, it actually does the opposite. It removes accountability. And we now have local councillors popping up all over the country who are realising that their power is being stripped away. And about 2 months ago, two councillors in Plymouth, who have recently resigned from the Labour Party because they can't stand the corrupt bullying, etc., going on in it, were prepared to tell me that they'd been on a course run by the local government association. And on that course, one of them was told specifically that in the not too distant future, there will only be appointed positions and democratically elected local councillors will cease to exist. And he told that to me face to face. So I believe that the devolving of power is a smokescreen. What you are actually doing is building, you are building centralised control to the lowest level. And we know for a fact that we're now seeing parish councils drawn into this system, so that approaches are being made to parish councils by universities very often, saying that they're going to train them in how to deal with the new structures of government and the stakeholder system. And what it's actually doing is sucking power away from the parish councils. And I was a parish councillor at one stage.
These are, in fact, the other name for these are quangos, and there are something in excess of 1,000 of them.
Well, that's correct, but we have to go a step further, because there are quangos that are identifiable as quangos, and then there are other partnership bodies which you can't actually define because they fall in between it. Yeah. If you go onto the internet, start to look, where's a good city for you to look at? Swindon. Put in the word Swindon and partnership or partnerships, and you will start to see these little clusters of groups. And if you go and dig into them and you say, well, who are these people? Where did they come from? How did they get appointed? You won't find any track. But what they do get is government money. And this is one of the ways that all of the European money's been used. If I take Cornwall, in Objective 1 funding, 320 million was pumped into Cornwall about 10 years ago. And if you say to somebody, OK, where's the accounts? How was it spent? They can't tell you. 51 million of single regeneration budget, was pumped into a company created by Plymouth City Council. And no councillor, and I couldn't get at it, ever saw the accounts of where that money was spent. Now, once a year, you're entitled to go into a council as a member of the public and ask to see the accounts. We did it. And we never saw the accounts for that money. And the reason is it's broken into little pockets, and then that is filtered out to these little quango organisations so that people feed. And in Devonport, where my real story starts, because that's where the threats and intimidation started, £25 million disappeared into an area of the city. Nobody ever saw a full set of accounts, but amongst other things the money was spent on, £5,000 went on paying for somebody's private wedding reception. When a member of the public alerted Alison Seebeck MP to what was happening, I've just said that on camera, the gentleman received a phone call where it was suggested this was not very helpful, that he should be inquiring about what was happening. Why would anybody do that? Right? So the system you're up against, we are up against, is massive. It's not talking about subverting a community. It's talking about attacking the whole fabric and structures of a society. If you go and read some of the papers of a gentleman called Gramsci, who was an Italian fascist, but that of course is based on Marxism, he wrote a couple of beautiful papers about how you destroy society, Western society, by merging the public and the corporate sectors, attacking the institutions, undermining the politicians, and this leads to the collapse of the society. And I say to you, as an ex-naval officer trained in warfare, you are living it. You are living it.
The quanga system, from what you've just described, looks to be a very useful way of rewarding placemen or dummies to do your dirty work for you.
Absolutely, because corruption is the best method by which you destroy morality and you control people. That's why I have a very experienced gentleman who's up in the Sheffield area, and he exposed what was happening with massive amounts of money, and his reward for alerting the then chief executive of Sheffield City Council was to be threatened, bullied and intimidated to a horrific extent which cost him his marriage.
In our newsagents, I saw a copy of the Western Mail.
Yep.
And there was a big headline, the chief executive of the Royal Mint is given a bonus of £1 million or something of
yep.
that nature. So that intrigued me. I bought it, and his remuneration was effectively doubled by that bonus.
Yep.
Now, it just so happens that the Royal Mint have been churning out currency with Britannia left off the coinage. Yeah. I just wonder if that is a reward for the work that chap is doing, removing the British identity of our coinage.
I don't know, but I think it'd be something worth investigating because I think it smells.
We've got a question. Sorry about your sound. We've got a lady here with a question. But first of all, I've got a very, very quick one for you. On the same subject, how many of you are aware that the post office has a banking service? Everybody knows the post office has a banking service. Do you know who it really is? Do you know who you're dealing with? JP Morgan. Check it out, it's true. Your question?
Obviously I agree with what you're saying.
You don't have to, it's not compulsory. You can.
what is it that you would suggest? You know, it's all very well just kind of refusing to comply with these things, but when you find yourself in a position, you know, sometimes you have to comply in order to,
yeah.
to not draw attention to yourself or want to be better phrased or something.
Well, as some of the other groups are saying, and I think this is an important one, you've got to do what you feel comfortable with.
Yeah.
Now, there are people out there who really don't give a what's it, and they're prepared to get banged up in prison. I personally think that's a bit of a shame, because if you get banged up in prison, you can't do anything. So the art is to take it as close as you feel comfortable. But anything you do, supposing you want to actually really challenge where the local authority is spending your money, yeah, all of people are getting tight for money now, and you say, okay, where's it being spent? And you grip that, and you don't let it go. You see councillors, you get, hey, do you know your money's going in this? Most people don't know where their money's going. And you don't take no for an answer. So when they try and fob you off and block you and stall you, call you vexatious, because that's where they get to, that's the psychological attack. You're vexatious, and then you become a domestic terrorism. Great. Okay, but you go as far as you like, but do something. That's the thing.
We've got a bit of internal politics here. I offended Alistair earlier, shut him up. So we're going Alistair, Margaret, and then Simon. Okay?
Yep.
Right, well, it's not quite as important as the 101 I was just now, but we'll talk to you after that.
Just stick off the piece.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So, come on. When I met someone in Devizes, just a couple asked where the castle was, which is
yeah.
the way, I don't know where. I didn't know when I explained it to them. And I said, well, where are you from? Plymouth. homeless, and what's it like down there politically? I had a great question. Gosh, he said, it's like the Gestapo.
Yeah.
Well, I said, I know someone from there that would agree entirely with what you just said. And it was funny, just strangers on the streets, I might say, had that feeling of what your town or city has become.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you something interesting is that, I'll say what I've heard, because then you know the level the information's come. I have heard there's a war going on at the moment in Plymouth between the Masonic movement, which is traditionally conservative aligned, and the Common Purpose movement, which is New Labour aligned. And we've recently had a change of control so that the old Labour government is out and and the Conservatives are in. And the Conservatives, I think, are finding that their Masonic networks are not working. And this is because Common Purpose is blocking those networks. And I've also heard that story repeated about some other cities. And I have also heard, and I'm just saying I've heard, so you can take it or leave it, I've also heard that we are now, for the first time, starting to see people in the Masonic movement leaving or questioning what their leaders are asking is done. And that's a very interesting situation. The person who asked me about Northern Ireland, the other thing I wanted to say about Northern Ireland is we have some very good people over there. I provided the information about the Common Purpose trained people in Northern Ireland, and the gentleman said he went and used it. And I said, so what happened? And he said, well, a person eventually lost their job after exposure, but something happened to a friend of mine, which hasn't happened in ages, and that is they got a warning. And I said, what do you mean? And they said, well, somebody turned up in his shop and suggested he might like not to do what he'd been doing. And the bloke said that hadn't happened in my circuit in Northern Ireland for some years. The other thing that I am reliably informed of is that European Union officials are now visiting Northern Ireland on a weekly basis, like they, quote, own the place.
Margaret, wake up, it's your turn. You've been trying about a dozen times, haven't
you? Well, one of the things that I've been suggesting, and perhaps I keep wondering whether to do it myself, and I wonder why people in Britain aren't doing it, is to stand outside the bank, the Royal Bank of Scotland and Lloyds, and the other bank that Lloyds joined up with, to say to people as they're going in, why are you still using this bank? This bank is not paying out money to small businesses, or not very much, as they should be doing. It's your money that's been put in there. They are, what's the other thing that I'm doing? Anyway, you know, we should stand outside and object to what's going on.
Well,
lots of people did it.
Yeah.
Never mind. We are going to get removed by the police eventually. So we do need to make a statement, we do need to do something.
Margaret, that's Lawful Rebellion at work, and I'd say brilliant, but I've actually tried a little bit of this, and rather than stand outside the bank, you go in the bank to do your business, and you start talking to the person behind you. It's best when you're getting close to the counter, and you say, do you know about what's happening with the world money supplies, that they are actually fraudulent and collapsing? And the people get quite interested, and you have a little discussion, and you're amazed at who's listening, because they're in the bank. And then when you get to the counter, you say to the lady on the till, or the man on the till, what do you think about these banks getting close to collapse? And they look at you, and then they say, oh, well, this is Lloyd's Bank, that can't ever happen here. And you say, oh, well, I think it's getting close. Absolutely.
It says it in cash now. They're doing a big columnist by paying it in shares.
Yeah.
The other thing, I just want to say something else as well. I would advise everybody here to get the book by Sarah Upley, Don't Blame Me Buried, I think it's called.
Correct. Yeah.
And everybody write to the newspapers and ask for the ban on Dunblane to be lifted. We want to know who's behind it, because the people who are behind it are the people I am quite certain that Brian has been talking about tonight.
Right.
And if you read Sarah Utley's book, every paragraph contradicts the official evidence. It's just an amazing book,
yeah.
Absolutely amazing. And another thing is that We've just had 2 men extradited to the European Union from Cornwall. They are in a KGB-style prison in Budapest. They are being emotionally ill-treated. Their food is horrendous, a piece of pork fat and a thick piece of pork fat, no meat, and a piece of bread is their diet, apart from soup. They've lost 2 stone in about 2 months. The first appearance in court, the prosecution was there, and the prosecution lawyer. The 2 men weren't there, and neither was the defence lawyer.
That's corpus juris, I believe.
That is corpus juris, yes. And what they are suffering is absolutely horrendous. You can find them on the website. We've got a few of the DVDs here, not many, but there are a few. And what they are suffering is what we are all going to suffer. You can be picked up.
Well, Margaret, the easy thing is that we've now got the first court case happening where there is no jury. And that was in the national papers, and that is corpus juris. And we know that the plan is that we juries are removed. And the reason you remove juries is because then you can do what you like in the courts. And that's what's coming.
But the European police can come at any time of the day or night, and under a mistaken identity, it can be you, any of us here, can be taken back to the European Union, put in a KGB-style prison, and these men can be kept there for 3 years, not 28 days. They've been there for about 5 months now, and no charge has been laid against them.
Yeah.
It's horrendous.
Well, these are all the things which need to come out, and it's interesting that the stuff is now, the knowledge is all coming out of you. I'd just add one thing. If you go down the trail of the banks, the Deutsche Bank is a very interesting bank, because Deutsche Bank is a big supporter of Common Purpose going into schools. And if you do your history on Deutsche Bank, you'll find there's a gentleman called Mr. Abs involved with it. Mr. Abs was connected with IG Farben Auschwitz, and then he remained with the bank till 1992. And if you then have a look at the BBC, which we know has been taking European Investment Bank money, you will find that when you complain to the BBC, of course you don't complain to the BBC because all the phones are answered by a company called Capita. And when you go and do your research on where Capita hold their board meetings, you will find that it's in Deutsche Bank. But don't worry, because the port of Dover is being sold to the French and our airports have been sold to the Spanish. And they're all nice people, so we haven't got anything to worry about. I'm sorry I said that, I'll retract that statement. I think we've had enough. Let's be positive. You have to understand the enemy and his weapons, because if you don't understand that, you can't fight. Once we've done it, once we've understood it, you need to actually fight. We need to fight. And it's amazing what you can do once you start working with people in the right way. Forget the party political stuff, that's all labels. If you want to work in a party, do. Otherwise, just work with nice, ordinary people. And I think we're going to turn it round, and I think we're going to see some extraordinary sights this year.
Thanks, Brian. We did promise Simon the question.
Okay.
One last question.
Right, well, there were actually 2 parts to it.
Nothing tricky, because it's getting late.
In the newspapers today, it was reported that the chairman of Barclays was answering questions to the Commons Select Committee about this challenge to depositors' money being used in the investment banking casino businesses. It's a complete blind. The issue is not the cash. The issue is the capital. It's the capital that is meant to be protecting depositors' money that is being used to underwrite leverage that goes into the investment banking business. And I just wanted to mention that, because Obama's going off to completely the wrong thing. It looks beautiful, it plays wonderfully in the press, and it won't make a jot of difference.
And I'm sure that's deliberate. You've got a second part.
The other thing I just wanted to mention about Afghanistan and the heroin business. And I wondered if you had any comments you'd like to make about the involvement of the intelligence agencies in the global drug trade.
Well, from all the research I've done now, I am very happy. And it's an interesting thing, isn't it? David Shaler, Maybe people in this room have heard David Shaler speak, and I have been previously and heard him speak quite a long time ago, and Annie Machon talking about the security services. Now, David Shaler's sort of discredited at the moment because he's into dresses, but he said something which I thought was very interesting when he was still wearing trousers. And he said that far from protecting the British public need protecting from the security services. And as an ex-armed forces military person, I now believe that is absolutely correct. I have also been told, and this is getting sensitive stuff, so I just have to say by a source, that British military people in Afghanistan have been specifically told that they are not to damage poppy crops. Make of that what you like. And if I disappear tomorrow, you'll know everything I've told you is true.
I can actually corroborate what you just said. My nephew's been in Afghanistan, and that is the case.
Thank you very much. I like you.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you check your watches, you'll see it's nearly 11 o'clock. Graham just wants to say something quickly about the poop show.
No, it's a small question, if I may. And I applaud what you're doing, and I think you're absolutely right, that what they fear most is exposure. And by presenting the cases that you are on the various psychopathic groupings that you've uncovered, and the more you uncover, the more there are, the more you... I wondered what the UK column view or your view was of how another psychopathic political entity going through its actions, you could view it as such, fits into this, and that is the influence of Zionism on the global stage, on banking, on political lobbies, as you've mentioned, all of these influences, even through to the foundations of Marxism and communism.
I think it's a subject that definitely requires research on an individual basis, because the moment you start to read well-written, deep research and historical papers on the subject, you will find that there is clearly a hand of Zionism at work, and that can be seen behind communism. I believe there's quite an interesting book called Behind Communism. It does, of course, raise some very delicate issues, and perhaps I can tell you how delicate it is, because 2 years ago, the UK column produced an article which was entitled From Israelites to Zionism. And for anybody reading the article, and that would include anybody who was a member of the Jewish community or not, the article was actually pro-Jewish. Not necessarily pro-Zionist, but pro-Jewish. And one day, I had a visit from two police officers. And they were lady police officers, they were in plain clothes, and they came into the little office that we have, and they informed me that they'd had a complaint about that article. And I was very interested in this. And I asked who had made the complaint. And they ummed and ahed a bit. And then they mentioned an MP's name, which I won't repeat. And they said that basically the matter had gone as far as the Crown Prosecution Service. But the Crown Prosecution Service had decided not to prosecute, but rather felt that they should come and give me a warning. And so I said, well, that's very interesting, because it might be nice to know that somebody's made a complaint before it goes to the Crown Prosecution Service, but have you read the article? And the police lady said something remarkable. They said, no. So I said, so you've come to give me a warning about an article that you've never read. And one lady had a rather low, not indecent, but a fairly low top. And I noticed that she started to blush a bit here. And she said, well, we haven't read it, but we've been told to come and tell you off, basically. And I said, well, if you had read the article, you would realise that the article was actually pro-Jewish, which it was. And we only ever had one telephone call from a member of the public about that article, and it was a Jewish gentleman based in Cornwall who said it was the best article he'd ever read on that subject. So I then asked the two police ladies whether they would like to discuss some more pertinent things, like the fraud at Fort Bovisand, which was an MOD property in Plymouth, at which all sorts of skullduggery went on. And in particular, Devon and Cornwall police have some rather unsavoury connections. I'm very happy with this because there's rather a lot of evidence on it. And the blush got more and more and more and more. And then she said, I think I'm going to terminate this discussion. And she left. So that was a story in answer to your question, but I believe we do need to look at this issue. And as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't matter what race, creed, religion somebody is. We know who we're looking for. We're looking for people who are immoral, crooked, nasty people, and they exist amongst Christians and Muslims and Jewish communities. So we shouldn't be squeamish, but we also need to be aware that there's some very powerful forces at work out there, particularly when you get on this very delicate subject. But I would encourage everybody to read, because I started to discover some very interesting factors about who actually funded the Bolshevik regime. And the banking community, never mind what religion is connected to it, the banking community is quite obviously guilty of making regimes which then foment wars. I don't have any doubt about that. Well, one last statement, and go and challenge your MP. Who's your MP down here?
At the moment, Mike Lancrum, but he's retiring.
Well, I've already challenged a new one, and I asked her a few questions.
Is Mr. Rankin retiring? Did he have a wisteria problem or something like that, was it?
Yeah, but we've got a new Claire Perry coming on the scene. I've met her twice.
Well, ask your MP why...
MP, yeah,
well, OK, go and find an MP and ask the MP why MPs are not allowed to ask questions about the Bank of England in Parliament. That is fact. The bank that controls your money, my money, our own MPs are not allowed to ask questions about that bank.
Gave them superior...
No, it's not to do with that. It's far deeper. It's far deeper than that.
Well, I know, but that's what we're...
But the bank runs our money, and our own MPs are not allowed to ask questions about its activities in Parliament. That's extraordinary.
Well, it was started off in 1680 by a certain breed of people.
Would you like to help me here, Mike?
You don't need any help.
We're not going to answer any questions. We still don't answer the questions. So.
But the trick is to keep asking the questions, because the questions cause them stress. And I would like to think that our MPs are stressed up to the eyeballs.
And the next question is to ask about the Bank of England nominees. But what's a lot more simple and a lot more fun is to walk into your local bank and ask the lady or the gentleman behind the counter for an information leaflet on fractional reserve banking.
Okay.
They go,
you what?
Do it, it's funny, it really is. Ladies and gentlemen, Lieutenant Commander, I think that's correct.
That's correct, yeah.
Brian Gerrish, one of the new retired.
Thank you. Brilliant, thank you. Thank you for putting it together, that's good.
I'm sure this is just the end of the beginning.